Here in the Leiden Museum, we have three statues from one and the same tomb. They were bought at the same moment, 1828, and they represent the tomb owner, Maya, his wife, Merit, and the couple together, Maya and Merit, seated side by side. Maya must have been very fond of statues. He was very wealthy, he had the means to acquire statues, he had the means to pay for the best sculptors in the whole of Egypt. So he must have thought, why not go on? I'll buy a couple more. And in fact, we have found four empty bases in the tomb during our excavations. Three of them may have been from these sculptures. But there was another damaged sculpture still standing there when we walked in. And there may have been at least one more. So altogether, at least six statues, I think, for this high official. Two of them were double statues. And we see man and wife side by side, both of them almost life-size, I think they are over life-size, in fact. They are shown as people of equal rank. In Egyptian art, you sometimes see that the husband is much larger than the wife. Not here. This was a different period, a period of, you might say, emancipation of women, a period when people were not afraid to show their affections, their emotions. And that's what we see here. Although you might say, well, the husband doesn't show his emotions. He sits in strict frontal position. But the wife embraces her husband. She has her arm behind the back of her husband. And that's what we see a lot in this period.
What is this thing that we see on the chest?
We see these persons wearing their best clothing. The husband has a long, like a galabia of the modern Arabic population of Egypt, a long garment with openings for the arms, and it reaches down to halfway his lower legs. Around that, he has bound another piece of cloth with a knot in front, and then it hangs down in many pleats. So that's two pieces of clothing, one over the other. The wife, on the other hand, has a looser garment, which consists of a large piece of linen wrapped around the body with a knot under the breast. And we can see the lines of the linen which are directed towards that knot that is here on the chest. Both husband and wife has wonderful wigs. The wig of the husband has long vertical strands over the top of the head, and then there are two masses of hair hanging down on the shoulders, and they have a different structure, little cylindrical locks of hair. The wife has a very long wig hanging down in vertical strands, and on either side of the face she has a separate strand that adds to the attraction of this sculpture. And when you talk like an art historian, I would like to add this is a very important dating criterion. This occurs only between about 1330 BC and say 1280 BC. That's the time that these sculptures were made. And then it disappears again.
In your knowledge, how long did it take to make a tomb?
We know from our excavations that sometimes making a tomb could take many, many years. We just excavated an example where we can be sure that constructing and decorating the tomb took about 20 years. People had to save money, so when they had a bit of capital together, they started. They started in a simple way, and then they maybe their position became more elevated, they got more money, there was no money, but more wealth, and they contracted another builder, another mason, another sculptor, and said, please go on, I want something more. And they built some more courts or chapels to that tomb, made more wall reliefs. This could take a long time.
Do you think that for them this tomb constructing was some kind of was meant also for their social image in their life
exactly.
and the afterlife?
Exactly.
Can
yeah.
you tell
yeah.
us a little
yeah.
bit about?
Yeah. In the decoration and the inscriptions of such tombs, the tomb owner wanted to tell about himself and about his social rank. It was very important. So it was not only a means of surviving in the hereafter, showing rituals, offerings, showing contacts with the gods, but he also demonstrated who he was, what his social rank was, what his daily life was. So there are scenes of daily life, and the image he wanted to convey was how important he was. So it was a means of making clear to people who visited the tomb how very, very important this person had been in their society.
When you saw this once and you entered the room in Saqqara, what was your feeling about it?
The Leiden excavations in Saqqara started in 1975. We had an old map of the 19th century of one explorer who had seen the tomb of Maya in 1843. But then it was covered in sand again by the wind, the eternal wind of the desert that brings in new sand. So we had no idea. We started our excavation. We found the tomb, and it was not the tomb of Maya. There was a mistake in the map. And it took us 12 years before we located the tomb of Maya, which was just 30 meters further on. And that was such a wonderful experience when we walked in first in the underground parts of the tomb, the actual burial chambers that had been cut out from the rock. And there, on the rock, there were panels of limestone, which we never see in Saqqara, but Maya wanted it to be beautiful, so we had these panels underground, 20 meters underground, and it said in large hieroglyphs, "This is the tomb of Maya. This is what you have been looking for 12 years. That was a fantastic moment.